Biblical Talks podcast with Michael Tolliver. This podcast is dedicated to biblical teaching and having worldview discussions from a biblical perspective. Here is today's podcast.
Welcome to Biblical Talks. V-O-M, live and faith. Hearts of five virtues, live and faith. I hope you really enjoy this show. It's talk. Virtue.
Welcome to the Hearts of Fire virtual event brought to you by the Voice of the Martyrs in partnership with Lifeway. During this program, we are joining together with believers from around the world to hear inspiring testimonies of four women who have endured persecution for their faith in Christ. We'll also have an opportunity to worship the Lord together, led by Michael W. Smith. And there will be an opportunity for you to encourage widows of Christian martyrs and let them know that they're not forgotten. Let's dive right in with our first speaker, Gracia Burnham, a former missionary hostage and the author of In the Presence of My Enemies.
Martin and Gracia Burnham served for 17 years with New Tribes Mission in the Philippines. Martin was a jungle pilot serving missionaries in remote areas. Gracia served in various roles, supporting the aviation program and also homeschooled their children, Jeff, Mindy, and Zach. On May 27, 2001, while celebrating their 18th wedding anniversary at a resort off Palawan Island, the Burnhams were taken captive by a radical Islamist group called Abu Sayyaf. In the ensuing months, some hostages were killed. Others were ransomed to freedom. For more than a year, they were constantly on the move, living in primitive conditions in the jungle, completely under the control of their captors. The Burnhams endured 17 gun battles between their captors and the Philippine military. They witnessed unspeakable atrocities committed by the men of Abu Sayyaf, but also experienced God's grace and presence during their captivity. On the afternoon of June 7, 2002, more than a year after their abduction, the Philippine military attempted yet another rescue. Martin was killed during the ensuing gunfight. Gracia was also shot, but survived and was rescued. She returned to her children in the U.S. and to a national spotlight. Gracia is in demand as a speaker and is the author of two books, In the Presence of My Enemies and To Fly Again.
There was a long night in October while we were held captive. By that time, we'd been in the jungle for about 5 months, and we were getting to know the guys who were holding us, learning their stories. Some said that they were coerced into becoming Abu Sayyaf members. You know, if a band of 30 Abu Sayyaf with their guns and machetes came through your village and asked for 3 volunteers, it's pretty likely that you would come up with 3 volunteers to send them, rather than to make these mujahid, these holy warriors, mad because everybody'd heard what happened if you didn't comply with the Abu Sayyaf that came through. Massacres, beheadings, looting. One kid had spent some time with Martin. I can't remember his name right now, which bothers me a bit. This kid was about 18 years old. His father was a poor fisherman, and he had no education. But he fell in love with a girl in a neighboring Muslim village. And in their culture, the guy pays the dowry, the bride price, and the family was asking 50,000 pesos. $1,000 or so, which might be a lot for some of us to come up with, but how much more this kid whose family had nothing. So he decided to join the Abu Sayyaf in hopes that he would be around when a ransom payment was made and he could take his share of the money and go get married to his sweetheart. This particular night, we had heard that the military was near, so we had mobiled long into the night. We walked till 3:30, 4 in the morning, and were just exhausted and lay down in a field of long grass to get some rest. Suddenly, the sky lit up with a bright light, almost like daylight, and a parachute opened up, and that light floated to the ground right near us. Anyone watching could have seen the whole group. And Martin leaned towards me, and he whispered, "Oh, no, they found us. That was a flare. They were just confirming that we were here. And I expected us to get up and keep moving, because one of the unwritten rules between the Abu Sayyaf and the military was they never had gun battles at night, but no one moved. We were exhausted. We couldn't go on and lay there the rest of the night. Early the next morning, right at dawn, we heard the distant rumble of huge trucks, and we knew that they were full of soldiers, and we got up and began moving out of this shelter towards a big field in the valley. And within minutes, we heard someone over in the trees yell, "There they are. Hoy, it's the Abu Sayyaf." And the guns started blaring. "Well, this is it," I thought. As we ran and dropped and ran and dropped, our guards would tell us when to run, when to drop. There was automatic gunfire everywhere, the pops of the rocket launchers, people yelling, the smell of gunpowder. And somehow we made it across that field. And little by little, the group started arriving in the woods. And we got down behind some big, huge boulders and headed off running down into the jungle. And when we stopped an hour or so later for a rest, I heard that that kid, you know, the one whose name I can't remember, was killed in the gun battle, shot in the gut with a 57 mortar. And I was devastated. Here was this kid. He just wanted to get married, entering eternity without God. And I didn't want to think about it. But I couldn't help but think about it and the horrible situation these guys were in and how things kept going from bad to worse for us. And I was just so scared and traumatized and depressed, and I just sat there and bawled. And then I thought, "Gracia, you need to get yourself together. We're going to start walking again soon." So I started to thank God for all the good things he'd done for us that day. We were still alive. I wasn't wounded. I'd lost my black burqa-type headdress that was so oppressive that I just hated. It had fallen somewhere out there on the field when we were running and dropping, so I could feel the wind in my hair again. I began reciting verses quietly out loud to calm myself. "I will never leave you or forsake you. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in time of trouble. Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world." I wonder if some of you were praying for us while I was working through that day. Many of you have said, "We prayed for you." And I never want to pass up the opportunity to say thank you for praying. Every time you prayed, we needed it. That day, as I sat cross-legged on the ground, I realized that in every situation, if you look, there's good, because God is there in your situation, and God is good. I'm so happy to be here for this Voice of the Martyrs meeting. an event. VOM was some of the first that came alongside me and my children after my jungle experience. And we've become dear friends over the years. And I've gotten to observe how well set up they are all around the world to assist the persecuted. And I don't take it lightly that I'm able to be here with them and with you. Our problem seemed especially daunting the night the military started shooting artillery at us. Always before, artillery fire had been during the day. We would hear the thump from the shells being fired some 10 miles away, and we would start counting. One, two, three. Often as we counted at about 10, there would be an explosion, sometimes near, sometimes far. It was disconcerting when they began shelling constantly, even at night. We would lay on the jungle floor and it would over our heads. We wondered if in the next few seconds after that faraway thump, the mortars would this time find us. You know what I love about our God. As Martin and I lay on the jungle floor praying, we prayed to a God who knows how we feel. And we can come boldly to God right then and there when we need help. Hebrews 4:14-16 says, "So then, since we have a great high priest who has entered heaven, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to what we believe. This high priest of ours understands our weaknesses, for he faced all the same testings we do, yet he did not sin. So let us come boldly to the throne of our gracious God. There we'll receive his mercy and we'll find grace to help us when we need it most." Our God knows how we feel when we're in need because he became flesh and lived down here on earth. He knows the human condition. And when we come to him, he doesn't think, "Well, that problem's dumb." I've heard the comment, "You're small. I expected you to be bigger. How did such a small person survive a year in the jungle?" I have no idea. And I don't even like to camp. I'm a city girl. My husband and I were missionaries with New Tribes Mission in the Philippines. New Tribes Mission has recently changed their name. It's Ethnos 360 now. Martin was what we called a jungle pilot, delivering supplies and taking people in and out of remote locations. We loved our ministry. And we'd been in the Philippines for 16 years. When we found ourselves in the wrong place at the wrong time, taken hostage. How did we survive that year? I believe God did something special for us. No one plans on being taken hostage. And we didn't train for that sort of thing. And suddenly our world was turned upside down, surrounded by enemies. Days dragged on and on. We got hungrier and dirtier. We suffered from lack of sleep because we couldn't get comfortable sleeping on the jungle floor. We got dysentery and diarrhea. No place to take a bath. No clean clothes to change into. And I started feeling more like an animal than a human being. Always thirsty. One day we were desperate and I was begging God for something to drink and we came upon this little pool of stagnant water. And as I dipped my cup in, I saw that there were leech eggs in it. And the enemy began to whisper in my ear, "Has not God said, where is your God and his loving kindness now?" When the enemy comes in like a flood, God will raise a standard against him. We overcome by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of our testimony. What was that scripture again? The word. When the enemy whispers. Let's read from Hebrews 4 once more. So then, Since we have a great high priest who's entered heaven, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to what we believe. This high priest of ours understands our weaknesses, for he faced all the same testings we do, yet he did not sin. So let us come boldly to the throne of our gracious God. There we will receive his mercy, and we will find grace to help us when we need it most. Jesus knows what it's like to be thirsty. He was led by the Spirit into the wilderness for 40 days and 40 nights to be tempted by the devil. He was hungry and he was thirsty. On the cross, he cried, "I thirst." And I don't think he's forgotten how that feels, folks. God knows how we feel, and he cares, and we can come boldly to him with our problems. So, what's true of you today? Do you have a problem? Are you walking down a trail that you would rather not be walking down? Is victory in your life non-existent? Do you feel alone? Have you come to the end of yourself? We all have our jungles, don't we? At the year mark of our being held captive, we were at an all-time low. Who would have ever thought that this nightmare would continue for over a year? Martin, for some months, had been eyeing a shortwave radio that one of the guys had, and he got up the nerve to ask Abu Sabaya, one of the leaders of the group, if he could borrow it. We were searching around looking for Voice of America or something English speaking to get some news when we came across a Christian radio station out of Alaska. We turned in just as a pastor was reading verses about how Christ is seated at the right hand of God, making intercession for us. He said, if you could hear Jesus in the next room praying for you, you would not be afraid of any enemy. And then he went on to pray for those who were suffering hardship for the sake of the gospel. He prayed for those under oppression and those living in war-torn areas. And Martin and I looked at each other with big eyes. That's us. He's talking about us. That message on the radio, it wasn't long at all, was the first spiritual input from the outside that we had had in over a year. So refreshing. The reminder that Jesus can sympathize with what we're going through and that he's praying for us. During your hardship, please know that God has not abandoned you. No matter what situation you find yourself in today, you are not alone. He knows how you feel, and he's given you special permission to come straight to him with your burdens. We kneel right there at God's throne, right there where Jesus is sitting. Wow. I'm glad that God explained, that Jesus explained to his disciples, to us, that living the Christian life is not going to be easy. He actually said, in this world, you will have problems. Things will be hard, guaranteed. There's no safe, easy way to be a follower of Jesus. In late August 2003, the New York Times reported on a theft at the Church of the Holy Cross in Midtown Manhattan, when caretakers noticed on Sunday morning that a 200-pound plaster rendering of Christ had been removed from a wooden cross near the church's entrance. The fact that a statue was stolen was less surprising than how it was stolen. The statue was about 4 feet long with a steel core and had been bolted to the cross in four places. The thieves had entered the church, unbolted the figure of Jesus, and carried it off, leaving the cross behind. One of the caretakers told the Times, "They just decided we're going to leave the cross and take Jesus. We don't know why they took just him. We figure if you want the whole crucifix, you take the whole crucifix." In essence, the thieves wanted Jesus, but not the cross. What about us? Do we want Jesus without a cross? Do we want discipleship without sacrifice? Do we expect that our service to God obligates him to remove all suffering and obstacle from our path. For some of us, it's not really costing us a lot to follow Jesus, is it? Sometimes we hear, well, we all have our crosses to bear. My cross is that one class in school, or my cross is this health problem, or my cross is that family member. But I think we've lost the meaning of the cross. If you were living in first century Jerusalem and you saw someone surrounded by Roman guards carrying a cross down the street, there would be no question in your mind where that person was going. You would know that he was about to be taken outside of the city, laid on a cross, and crucified. Someone carrying a cross was someone who was about to die. So when Jesus said, "Whoever desires to come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me," his disciples would have understood exactly what he meant. And they took his words to heart, didn't they? Every disciple, except John, died a cruel martyr's death. They knew the words of Jesus to be true, that what we suffer now is nothing compared to the glory that he will give us one day, and that they could be of good cheer because their master and example, Jesus, had overcome the world. And now it's our turn. Untold millions have never heard that there is a Savior. And to take that message to them is going to be costly. It will cost us our money and our comfort. It will cost us careers and lifestyles. It will cost us our dreams and our plans. But we have the promise, "Lo, I am with you always." Well, maybe you've heard that I have a rest of the story. I have found a bunch of the guys that held us captive in a maximum security prison in Manila for the rest of their lives. Zacharias is there, the one who on May 27 burst into our room at Dos Palmas with his M16 and took us captive. Daoud, the guy that used to sit and talk with Martin when we would rest during our long days of hiking. In jail is Bashir, who was shot in the same gun battle that Martin was killed in, the one that rescued me. God raised up a missionary couple in the Philippines who had a heart for prison ministry. And I wish I had an hour to tell you the story. But so far, five former Abu Sayyaf that I know of have come to know Jesus as their Savior. You know what? There can't be a harvest without seed planters. And maybe planting seeds isn't always fun. And maybe planting seeds for you is downright uncomfortable and you don't see any fruit for your labors. You might wonder why you were called to plant seeds, because you're not even good at it. But all of a sudden you see what God's doing. And I've been reminded that the seed we planted in the jungle was not wasted. Others are reaping what we sowed ever so long ago. God's almighty. He can do anything. So by faith, keep planting those seeds, my friend, those seeds of the gospel that Christ died for our sins, the ones that God said will never be wasted. Keep on when you feel like giving up, when you don't know what you're doing. Keep on. It's God that's going to do the work on down the road. Who knows why God chooses one person to do one thing and he chooses another for someone else? Who knows why some of us grew up hearing the gospel of Jesus over and over and over, and some in the world will never hear it even once? Who knows why some of us live in abundance while our brothers and sisters in Christ starve or face extreme persecution in another land? I don't know the answers to those questions. What I do know is we have today, and we can do whatever we want to with today. And today, we're called to take up our cross, the one assigned to us. We're not to walk along murmuring at the cross that's been appointed to us. We're not to decide it's too heavy and lay it down and walk away from it. We boldly face it. We patiently endure it because we only have to carry it a little way and then our turn's over. And along the way, as those who don't know God see us carrying our crosses, we get to share with them the honor of knowing a living Christ. You can't be a disciple without cross bearing. Whether you're in the heat of the battle or one who supports or encourages those who are, we must consecrate our all to Jesus and take up our cross. And it doesn't matter that far better men and women than us have carried their crosses. We just need to be faithful with ours. And the promise of God is that grace will be given equal to the weight of the cross. And after our little while that we get to carry our cross is over, a crown is waiting at the finish line. No cross, no crown. I stand humbly looking back at my experience, grateful to know the Lord. It may seem strange, but I think God treated us very gently. How many things were graciously hidden from our eyes that year? And what an honor for a short period of time to experience the fellowship of His suffering. May God bless you.
We'll be back after a quick break. We'll be back after a quick break.
Each month, Elder Tolliver offers a spiritually encouraging book to help you in your walk with Christ for any size donation. Please go to biblicaltalks.com to take advantage of this opportunity.
Gracia, thank you for sharing your testimony with us. We're grateful that Michael W. Smith, a three-time Grammy Award winner and member of the Gospel Music Hall of Fame, is here to lead us in song. Please welcome Michael as we enter into a time of worship.
And draw me close to you. Never let me go. I lay it all down again to hear you say that I'm your friend. You are my desire, and no one else will do. Nothing else can take your place to feel the warmth of your embrace. Help me find the way and bring me back to you. Desire, and no one else will do. 'Cause nothing else can take your place. To feel the warmth of your embrace, help me find a way and bring me back to you. Above all powers, above all kings, above all nature and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man, you were here before the world began. Above all kingdoms, above all thrones, above all wonders the world has ever known, above all wealth and treasures of the earth, there's no way to measure what you're worth. Trampled on the ground, you took the fall and thought of me above all. Above all powers, above all kings, above all nature and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man, you were here before the world began. Above all kingdoms, above all thrones, above all wonders the world has ever known, above all wealth and treasures of the earth, there's no way to measure what you're worth. Crucified, lay behind the stone, you live to die, rejected and alone, like a rose trampled on the ground, you took the fall and thought of me above all. Crucified, lay behind the stone, you live to die, rejected and alone, like a rose were trampled on the ground. You took the fall and thought of me above all. Like a rose trampled on the ground, you took the fall and thought of me above. There is none like you, no one else can touch my heart like you do. I could search for all eternity long and find there is none like you. There is none like you. No one else can touch my heart like you do. I could search for all eternity though and find there is none like you. There is none like you. No one else can touch my heart like you do. I could search for all eternity long and find there is none like you. I could search for all eternity long and find there is none like you.
Thank you, Michael, for that time of worship. The book of James tells us that visiting orphans and widows in their affliction is one of the marks of religion that is pure and undefiled before God. Tonight, you'll have an opportunity to join with believers from around the world to encourage widows of Christian martyrs.
In India, Sukhbati's husband was killed for being a follower of Christ. Despite her loss, she says, I will not give up Jesus, because he will be with me to care for me and my children. In Nigeria, Justina's husband, Nehemiah, visited a nearby village to baptize new Christians and was killed by Fulani Islamic militants. Still, she says, I will not stop singing. In Pakistan, Islamists shot two church leaders as they drove away from their church. One of the men died, leaving behind a grieving wife and children. These are just a few of the thousands of widows and children of Christian martyrs that the Voice of the Martyrs supports each year. They receive practical assistance like housing, food, vocational training, and educational and spiritual support for their children. We walk hand in hand with these believers for as long as they need help. Through this event, we will ask that you consider giving to encourage these widows and their families. These women are bold in their conviction and commitment to Jesus Christ, but the opposition is difficult to face alone. Tonight, we ask that you consider a gift that will help meet their needs and let them know they're not forgotten by the global body of Christ. When you give to support these precious families, we'll send you a free copy of the newest edition of Hearts of Fire, including 12 new stories of courageous women like those you are supporting. Give now at vom.org/widows.
Again, you can give to let these precious women and their children know that they're not forgotten. Give online right now at vom.org/widows. Now, Todd Nettleton, the host of the Voice of the Martyrs Radio, is going to join us and talk with Anita Smith, whose husband was martyred as they did ministry together in Libya. Watch this video and please welcome Todd and Anita.
On December 5th, 2013, Ronnie Smith was shot and killed in the Libyan city of Benghazi. Ronnie and his wife Anita had moved to the city along with their young son Hosea less than a year before, with the hope of being a lighthouse for Christ in the war-torn North African country. They knew it would be dangerous. They arrived just months after the U.S. consulate was overrun by Islamist fighters who killed four Americans. But Ronnie and Anita settled into life there. God had opened the door for Ronnie to teach chemistry at an international school, and he quickly built relationships with his students. Anita developed close friendships with her neighbors and was often able to have spiritual conversations. Within days after Ronnie's death, Anita spoke on national TV in the U.S., about her God-given love for the Libyan people and about forgiving her husband's murderers. She also did interviews in Arabic that were broadcast all over the Middle East.
Thanks for doing this.
Thank you for having me.
I'm glad we get this opportunity. I think there will be a lot of questions from people who are watching this, and I think there are questions even in your own family. You're moving to Benghazi right after the U.S. consulate has just been attacked and four Americans have been killed. How much fear was there? Because it's obviously it's a dangerous place. How did you wrestle through that? And how did God, again, kind of confirm, nope, this is where I want you to go?
When I look back at it, so it's now been 9, 10 years, I ask myself the same question. Like, we took our infant to Benghazi. And at the time, I did have natural fears and I was worried, but it was still, I know for sure that we did have God's peace with us. And it wasn't some kind of superficial peace of that didn't have any fears in it, but we were able to give it over to Jesus. But it wasn't easy, and there was unrest, and we were taking our child there, but we were giving it over to Jesus, believing that he was going to be with us, and he was with us. But sometimes I do look back, and I'm like, was I a different person then?
So Ronnie is a chemistry teacher. He's going, he's in the classroom every day. He's teaching, he's interacting with students. Mm-hmm. What about your side of that story? What was your life and ministry like? Because obviously you're not out with students every day.
Right. What I was able to do a few times a week was teach English to the Libyan women at the International School of Benghazi.
Oh, okay.
So while he was at school, I was able to go for half a day with our son. Our son was in the daycare there. It was just half a day, and it was a few days a week. So I was able to do that. And then apart from that, it was mainly taking care of my son, visiting with the other mothers in the neighborhood, and just living, I mean, for the most part, an ordinary, simple life, but making those friendships with our neighbors.
Obviously, you can't go to Libya and say, we're here to be missionaries, we're going to plant a church.
Right.
But you're there to advance the gospel. Mm-hmm. You want to tell people about Jesus. How did you do that? Or how did you try to steer some of those conversations into spiritual things?
People asked all the time. I mean, being with, I would say, the Middle Eastern culture and seeing that we are Westerners and Americans, they would ask often, why would you move from the United States to Benghazi?
And so the same thing people here asked, why would you move to Benghazi?
Right. And we really believe it's not like every Christian, every believer is called to be a missionary, whether you are staying in your own neighborhood, in your school, in your workplace, in your own state, going to a different state or going to a different country. So we didn't have like this mission of changing a people. It was who we are in Christ. We are a child of God. And so we are just going to live our life out. And we wanted to do that in a place that didn't know Jesus and didn't know his extravagant love, his gospel. So we wanted to, we would tell, it was easy to speak to the Libyans and just tell them we believe that God wanted us to move here. We wanted to show you what love that we know is from Jesus, his peace. We know we can't transform all of Libya to be something different, but we can just be that one person to have friendships with you and be able to engage in a life with you.
Let's talk about the day in December of 2013. Mm-hmm. You and your son had come back early for Christmas. Ronnie was finishing out the semester, and then he was going to come for Christmas too. Talk me through that day and how you found out about what had happened.
So, it was in early December, and I had just spoken to Ronnie the day before, just our normal conversations, have a good night. And then that morning, it was breakfast for us, so about the 9 o'clock hour. And in Libya, it was in the afternoon. So I received a call from the Libyan family that we're very close with. The husband was one of Ronnie's best friends, and his wives was one of my friends, and their children played with my son. So they were very close. And their mother, their elderly mother, was there. So they FaceTimed or Skyped with me. And through tears, they were telling me, oh, we're so very sorry. Ronnie has died. And they didn't know how else to say it. It was just, I mean, how else can you just say that he's gone?
Obviously, you're in shock. You're in incredible grief. Mm-hmm. How did Jesus show up? How did God show up in that situation?
It was definitely immediate and every day. And even the immediate, I'll be honest, it was hard. It's not like it's okay, because it's not okay. But I mean, Ronnie's family out of state and in state just rushed to my house that day. Our church in Texas, same day, a group of them came and loved on me and wanted to care for me, wanted to pray with me. So all of that was like very present.
It's like the body of Christ, really being the body of Christ, literally putting Christ's arms around you. What did you hear? What happened? What did you hear had happened in Libya with Ronnie?
So, what had happened was he typically does go for daily jogs, and also sometimes with one of his friends from our neighborhood, they'll go together to make it to be more safe. And our other neighbor, just different neighbors, they would just say, just be careful, don't go out into the specific area where men do go jogging. So Ronnie did avoid that because of the advice that he was given. So he stayed jogging in our neighborhood. Some neighbors still didn't like that or prefer that, but Ronnie was giving exams that morning. And so it was half a day for him. So he left school about 10:30, whereas typically the day ends at 3. So he was jogging in our neighborhood. It was daylight. It was about 11 or 11:15 a.m. Benghazi time. And he was followed by a black Jeep. And supposedly there was a witness who heard some conversations that went on between the men in the Jeep, about 4 of them, with Ronnie. And the man who heard the conversations, he was in a parked car. He was waiting for his elderly mother to come down from her home. So he saw the Jeep suspiciously slow and going towards Ronnie, stopped, had a conversation, a short conversation, and they went around. And then he saw that Ronnie was jogging and turned a corner, and that the Jeep came back, and it just looked really just not good. And then he heard immediately the gunshots. So he knew.
So did he hear what they said to Ronnie?
Just hearsay, that just asking him, what's his name? Are you from here? Do you live around here? Kind of small talk. So I don't know if it was planned or if they were following him from school. I've heard rumors about that. Benghazi is a big city, but at the same time, it's like everybody knows each other. Everyone knows if you tell someone your last name that you're this family's, you're part of this family. So there were just rumors and talks that maybe he was followed. Why would they have known that he got out of school early that day, whereas usually the school day ends at 3 o'clock? And really, our neighborhood was quiet. So why was that Jeep in our neighborhood? It wasn't a busy neighborhood at all.
One of the things in your story that really amazes people and amazes me, quite frankly, is just a few days later, you're on national television forgiving the people who killed Ronnie, talking about how much you still love Libya and love the people of Libya. I was with, not very long ago, a person whose husband was martyred in the Middle East, and she talked about it taking 5 years to come to the point of being able to say, I forgive those evil men who killed my husband. You got there in 5 days. How did that happen? Kind of talk me through how you came to that point of saying, I'm not going to hate those people. I forgive them.
I really wanted, like, it was just a shock of it all happening. Yes, Ronnie and I talked about it before moving overseas, that that was a risk. And it's a closer reality of thinking, wow, this could really happen to us, than thinking, well, it wouldn't be us that it could happen to. But still, we always had thought, well, hopefully it won't be us. But we wanted our lives really to glorify Jesus. We only have one life here. Yes, we make a lot of mistakes, and we have the opportunity and the grace to ask for forgiveness. But we wanted our lives to be known that we love Jesus. And I do remember Ronnie saying before that if he could only have one person turn to Jesus with his life, that it would have been worth it. And I didn't, I mean, I wanted those people to know, the Libyans or the people that did the shooting, to know that Jesus is different. Jesus is a God that loves people who make mistakes and who do crime, and it's not okay what they did at all. That doesn't mean that they're freed from the consequences of it, but that Jesus teaches us to love our enemies, and that's what causes people to come to know Jesus and to come to know what the gospel is. And I've never been in a situation where someone has sinned against me to that degree where I've had to, where it's been hard to forgive somebody. And I just really wanted them to know, well, this is a horrific thing that you've done, but look at the extravagant thing that Jesus has done. And you can't beat us down. You can't beat me down. I'm going to show you that I want to forgive you.
Is that something you were able to feel right away? I mean, it's only been a few weeks. Sometimes, you know, people may get to that stage months or years later, but to feel that so soon, I think, is going to surprise a lot of people.
The first day of the incident, I wasn't even thinking in regards, any emotions in regards to the attackers, but it came really soon. It came within that evening or the second day. It's got to be God's spirit pouring into me, replacing that anger with his love. Yeah, they took away my husband, and I love my husband, but it's got to be God's spirit that's pushing me to show them that this is what God wants them to see. He wants them to see that love and forgiveness is real, even if they've done this to my husband, and I want them to see this and to know this.
And you really feel that in your heart. You don't feel anger. You don't feel hatred toward them. I mean, I'm sorry I keep bringing this up, but I think just, it's an extraordinary thing to be able to feel that.
I just envision the black Jeep driving up to him, and I don't know their faces. I just want them to know that God loves them and can forgive them for this. And I don't know them, but that's how I honestly feel. It may sound crazy, but it's God's spirit that's putting this inside of me.
Yeah. It doesn't sound crazy. It sounds,
and I believe it,
like you're a remarkable person to feel this.
You said in the time since then, when you've wrestled, it hasn't been with the Libyan attackers, it's been with God. How do those wrestling matches go? Is it you coming to God and saying, how could you let this happen? My husband was killed. Mm-hmm. My son doesn't have a father now. How do those conversations go?
So those are the really difficult ones that, yeah, just as the days pass and the months pass, and my son was 2 at the time, he's now 11. And we weren't there for a long time. We were building relationships, and it's like this short time that we were there that completely turned our world upside down for the rest of our lives. And I just ask God, yeah, I mean, times where I can trust him and I have to surrender it to him, even though I don't know. But, and then he does comfort me. And whenever I read the Bible, you know, our sufferings here are for a short time, compared to the eternal weight that we will receive of glory of being with Jesus. And I knew all this going in. Ronnie and I, we talked a lot about suffering. We spoke with other people that had gone through some suffering, and just what the whole gospel is, you pick up your cross, and if you are a disciple, it's not a matter of if you will suffer, it's when. And so when I have these challenging times with God, it's still even present today. I mean, my son is 11 years old, and when he was 2, he doesn't remember a lot of that. And now it's like a different stage of grief, because now he's 10, 11, and wishing just what he missed out on all those years.
How does God respond in those times to remind you of his grace and to remind you, I'm the husband of the widow?
I mean, it's definitely through friends and family. They have showered me with love, have always pointed me towards God, his comfort. And even if their love to me is like a silence, it's just them coming alongside me, not trying to make a lighter issue, but loving me and being able to walk through the pain with me, understanding that, you know, I'm not in your shoes, but this isn't easy, and we're not going to say that it's okay. And Jesus knows that. And I mean, when Jesus, a really powerful message that I remember was when Jesus was on the cross, he had 7 sayings, and one was to John, saying to take care of his mom, who is a widow. And there's just so much love that Jesus has to say, the Bible has to say about widows and orphans. And it's evident. And he's such a personal God that understands the pain that I went through and am going through. And he, I think, knowing that he's that God that is a personal God that understands that.
We heard a story just in the last couple of weeks, actually, of a Libyan brother who was inspired to accept Christ, reading your testimony on Facebook after Ronnie was killed. What does that do for you, that God used that to see a Libyan won to the kingdom?
It's really powerful for me to hear those stories, because I do feel at times, you know, we lived in Libya for that short period of time. What dent have we made to show who Jesus is? I mean, yes, I was able to speak on the news, but it's almost like it's the next news story. So that's forgotten. And then years pass. And so it's very special to me to hear when a Libyan has come in contact with what I said and pointing them to Jesus. And I do, and I know for sure at, when Jesus comes back, he says, people of all tongues, of all nations will be at the throne, and they will be there from Libya.
And we should say, we mentioned the media interviews here in the States in English, but you also did that in Arabic on Al Jazeera, mm-hmm. broadcast all over the Middle East. I think about Ronnie saying, if we could reach one Libyan, mm-hmm. you reached millions, thousands at least, tens of thousands. It's interesting how God has taken your sacrifice and Ronnie's sacrifice mm-hmm. and totally used it in the kingdom.
Yeah, and it's a way that I would have never probably even had guessed. I mean, because I'm thinking, well, Jesus, you asked us to go there, and we were there for such a short time, and now our time there has ended. So what did that help do? But I don't know what the future will hold, even when I'm not around, as far as how just being able to have that short time of a platform to be able to say that in their language, to be able to tell them exactly why Jesus died.
Richard Wurmbrand famously said, if you don't want any more martyrs, please don't give us any more money, because we're going to send more Bibles and there's going to be more people come to Christ, and some of those people are going to be killed. So if that makes you uncomfortable, you know, please don't give. We're asking people, we're telling people, do give, mm-hmm. do send more Bibles, do send more people to share the gospel. And we understand there's going to be more Anitas. There's going to be more Ronnies. Talk to us about why that's okay. I mean, why we should still, even knowing that people are going to suffer because of God, because mm-hmm. of his word.
Yes. I mean, it's not, being a Christian, I don't want to say it is a joy. And at the same time, that joy is with pain. I mean, the Bible gives us different examples of a woman going through labor. It is painful, but she gets the joy of her infant in her arms. And so walking with Christ is a joy. You get to see people who didn't know Jesus, and then they turn to Jesus. Or you get to pray alongside people that are in pain or who are suffering. And Paul tells us in Philippians that the gift of the gospel is a gift, and so is suffering for his sake. And
that's a gift none of us want.
Right. It's not. And I remember having a conversation with Ronnie saying that we need to pray that we will endure suffering, and it's not an optional thing. And it could be different for anybody. It doesn't mean everybody is going to die a martyr's death. And so it's so important to still provide the resources to send people to areas that people don't know Jesus, to get those Bibles out there. And yes, there will be deaths involved. There are so many right now as we're speaking that I don't know who's imprisoned. But we have to come alongside those people and those small groups of new churches to encourage them and to pray for them and to hear their stories so that we could know who they are. And
when there are deaths, when there are sacrifices, we need to be ready to be the body of Christ and come alongside those who are left behind.
Yes. I mean, it's just so important. I mean, like I said before, I could not have done this without the body of Christ, and still to this day. And it's a gift to be able to come alongside someone, just as I knew that they showered me with love and with prayers and with resources and gifts. My son and I, we wouldn't have been able to do what we did in terms of just surviving the day to day without their support. during my early stages of becoming a Christian, so in my early to mid-20s, I don't know how it happened, but I was receiving the Voice of the Martyr subscription, and I had never heard of the organization, and I was just shocked at that this even existed overseas, or that there were places where people were being persecuted. I didn't understand persecution and suffering for the gospel. I was in my early years of my faith. And so I remember, and I read Richard's early book, even before my church was big into suffering for Christ. And I was amazed by it, and it's always stuck with me. And then I would have never guessed 20 years later that I would be a part of anything with Voice of the Martyrs. So sometimes just thinking how God, you know, in my early 20s and 20 years later, how something I just didn't know existed in the gospel, that I'm living part of that out, and that I'm able to give my testimony to encourage others, that Jesus does call us to a life to live for him, and that it will be difficult, but it's what he showed us. He showed us that the road to Calvary is not an easy road, but that's what has given us the freedom and given us the ability to be with him forever after this life. And so I like being part of the Voice of the Martyrs is something I would have never thought of. It's almost like it's, if you ask me in my early 20s, would I ever want to? I don't know. That's scary. But this is how it's come about. And I hope that I hope that God can use my life and Ronnie's life and now our son's life to continue to point people to Jesus.
Amen. Anita, thank you so much for sharing with us. Thank you for being very real and very raw. And we honor you, we honor Ronnie, and we honor your sacrifice. So thank you so much.
Thank you again, Anita, for your courageous faith. What amazing an example it is for us of forgiveness. As a part of this event, we have mentioned the special emphasis to support widows of Christian martyrs. We'd like for you to meet a few of these courageous women and their children who are being helped through your giving.
My name is Rebecca. I live in the north of Nigeria. One evening I was out with my daughter, and on our way home we saw smoke rising above our village. We were under attack. There was nothing we could do to defend ourselves. I was devastated. I mourned for many months. Some of us were able to return to our village to reclaim anything that was left. Genesis and Revelation were burnt, but the rest was mostly intact.
They
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I still use this Bible. It reminds me of God's faithfulness. The Lord is a husband to all widows. I look to Him for every need. This is what I am still holding on to.
This is just one of the thousands of widows of Christian martyrs that the Voice of the Martyrs supports each year. They receive practical assistance like housing, food, vocational training, and educational and spiritual support for their children. We walk hand in hand with these believers for as long as they need help. Through this event, we will ask that you consider giving to encourage these widows and their families. These women are bold in their conviction and commitment to Jesus Christ, but the opposition is difficult to face alone. Tonight, we ask that you consider a gift that will help meet their needs and let them know they're not forgotten by the global body of Christ. When you give to support these precious families, we'll send you a free copy of the newest edition of Hearts of Fire, including 12 new stories of courageous women like those you are supporting. Give now at vom.org/widows.
Again, you can give a gift at any time during this event to support Widows of Christian Martyrs. Give right now, vom.org/widows. And now please welcome back Michael W. Smith.
For listening to Biblical Talks. This podcast is solely supported by listener donations. Please go to biblicaltalks.com to support this podcast and have a blessed day.